Well, good morning, everyone. It's good to see you guys today. I know some people are still kind of traveling in to find spots, which is totally fine. And kind of as we prepare today, going to state the obvious on two things here. And kids have picked up and paid attention to this probably more than the adults, although there may be a few adults that are a little bit bummed about this also. Since the week before Father's Day, we have been offering Duke's Donuts again. Today is the 4th of July. We're going to celebrate that. So is Duke's, which means Duke's is closed. So if you head that way and you're wondering, what? No sugar fix before service. We'll see how much everyone is affected by that today on energy level in here. Duke's is closed, and they're letting their employees, you know, celebrate 4th of July as well. But we're thankful for Duke's, so there's our shout out to Duke's as well. So the other thing, toward the end of the service today, we have an opportunity. Our youth group is going this coming Saturday, they're leaving for a mission trip to Mountaintop. So toward the end of the service, after the sermon and final song, we'll have an opportunity to pray for them and commission them. And I know some of our youth are involved in children's ministry and help in other areas, so that's why I'm announcing that now. Try to get back here around the time of the final song. If you can help it. So, and then a little bit later in this service, we'll also watch an Alpha Course video. We're starting a course called the Alpha Course, and it starts the Wednesday after Labor Day. And I'll give a text to the people that need to push play on that in a little bit as well. I just got a thumbs up. Our call to worship today is from John 4. 23 and 24, and then also a verse in 2 Corinthians. And just to kind of set the context here, this is when Jesus meets with the Samaritan woman, and they're talking about worship. And in 22 it says, "You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming, and is now here, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father is seeking such people to worship Him." And my kids and I went on a bike ride last night because everyone was blowing up fireworks because celebration of all of that. And we found we were seeking and riding here and there and everywhere, and wherever we saw light or we heard big booms, to try to get closer to the fireworks that everyone else in our vicinity was lighting off. What's crazy is God, as our Heavenly Father, says, "I am seeking actively also. I'm seeking actively those who worship me in spirit and in truth." And depending on how your morning was or how your week is, you may come in and go, "I don't know that I can get there. I'm worn out, I'm out of gas, I'm troubled, I'm tired, and I didn't even get my Duke's donut this morning." Here's the good news. Well, it's bad news that turns into good news. You can't get yourself there. And the first step in realizing, "God, I want to worship you in spirit and in truth," is realizing you can't get yourself there. But God, through Jesus, by way of the Holy Spirit, can get you there. So the first step in saying, "God, we're at this worship service with my church family, and I'm excited, but I'm tired, or I'm gassed, or whatever," is to be able to say, "God, I can't, but you can. Would you please help me? When we sing these songs, I want to feel them deep in my bones. I don't just want to read words on a screen. I want an encounter and an experience with the living God." And when you pray that way, you know what? God's faithful. He's seeking that kind of heart posture. And when he sees that in you, you're going to worship him in spirit and in truth, and you're going to encounter him in a special way. And then 2 Corinthians 3:17 says, "Now the Lord is spirit, and those who worship him." Hold on, sorry. Maybe I need reading glasses now. The Lord is spirit, and where the spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. We celebrate freedom today. We're thankful for our country and the freedoms that we have in our country, but there is no greater, better freedom than the freedom we have in Christ and the ability to worship him. So I invite you to stand, greet someone, say hi to someone that you know or maybe don't know, and then we'll prepare to sing.
Good morning, friends. Let's sing together.
Hark how the heavenly anthem
first song. All hail, Redeemer, hail, for he has died for me. That's why we are gathered this morning, to hail the name of Jesus, because he has died for us. His praise and glory shall not fail throughout eternity, because he is the Savior who has died for us. Let's keep singing to him and worshiping together, because he has died for us to save us.
Man of sorrows, what a name for the Son of God who came, ruined sinners to reclaim. Hallelujah, what a Savior. Stand unclean, no one else could. In my place condemned he stood. Now his nearness is my good. Hallelujah, what a Savior. Hallelujah, praise to the one whose blood has pardoned me. Oh, what a Savior, Redeemer and King, your love has rescued me. Lifted up was he to die, it is finished, was his cry. Now in heaven lifted high, hallelujah, what a Savior. And when he comes, a glorious King, all his ransom torn to bring, then anew this song we'll sing. Hallelujah, what a Savior. Hallelujah, what a Savior. Hallelujah, praise to the one whose blood has pardoned.
God, we praise the one risen Son of God. He is risen. He has died for us. He is risen. He is our advocate at your right hand, ever living to intercede for us. Our joy and our hope is totally in him this morning. He is the King. His throne is above all thrones. And we want all glory to go to him in our gathering this morning. God, we pray that just as we now open your word, God, be with Stephen as he opens your word to us, and continue to be here present among us by your Spirit. Work in our hearts and change us for your glory. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. You know, one thing that we can tend to forget and that we need continual help believing is that Jesus loves me. This I know. for the Bible tells me so. I don't think it's by accident that we tend to teach our kids that, but it may be to our detriment that we sometimes stop singing that song the older we get. Jesus loves me. This I know. I know. You see, it's interesting that the author of Hebrews says that without faith, it is impossible to please God. And sometimes, and not to say that this may not sometimes be the case, but we tend to think, oh, faith. Well, we know what Jesus says about faith. Faith the size of a mustard seed can command a mountain to move from here to there. And then we look and go, oh, man, I'm never going to please God. I don't have even the faith the size of a mustard seed to move a mountain from here to there. And where Jesus does say that, and where it is important to know that faith is powerful, faith is only so powerful as the thing you put your faith in. There are a couple chairs over here. You guys have heard an illustration like this before, I'm sure. I am going to exercise putting faith in this chair. And my faith was sure. Because you know what? If my faith wasn't sure, guess what's going to happen? The chair is going to be pretty weak, right? The chair is going to collapse, and I'm going to go, oh no, that chair can't hold me. Anybody ever been in a chair that's not so stable? Fallen out of a chair? Fallen back in a chair? It's a chair that you should not put your faith in, right? What if faith that pleases God is believing and knowing deep down in your bones, Jesus loves me. This I know, for the Bible tells me so. Every moment of every day, God is doing things to remind us that Jesus loves us. And we're going to see as we look at Acts chapter 11, which is kind of a continuation of this story of Peter getting his mind blown that the Gentiles are joint heirs and can be engrafted in as part of the family of God through a vision. We're going to discover that Peter needed to know not only Jesus loves me, this I know, but Jesus loves you, this I know. And in fact, Jesus loves the one that you would consider not lovable. That Jesus has died for all. So we get to experience how Cornelius has this vision from God, and then Peter has this vision from God, and they meet up and they connect, and there's a revival, and there's all of these amazing things happening and going on, and word travels from Joppa area all the way back to Jerusalem. Now, if you've ever been a part of something and you're super excited about it and someone throws a wet blanket on what you're excited about, they tend to kind of be a Debbie Downer type of person. I'm sure we don't have any Debbie Downers in this congregation. We're all really excited. We always get real pumped, right? Whenever we hear about God doing something really special, we just say, praise God. We never go, are you sure? Positive that wasn't just some weird emotional experience or the burrito you had way too late on Saturday night. We're not sure about that. We need to be suspect. We need to be questioning. We need to be skeptical. We need to be cynical. Now, there's a place for that also. You see, just like James says, faith without works is dead. Faith without evidence, okay, there will be a confirming thing that happens. One thing that's a problem sometimes amongst Christians in churches or circles is for someone to immediately disregard something before you even know what's happening with it. And there is, in fact, a party of people, like a political party, called the Circumcision Party, okay? And they are the ones that are looking at what Peter is doing with Cornelius, this Gentile, and saying, I'm not sure this is really a move of God. I'm not sure they really received the Holy Spirit. I think we need to go and we need to interrogate. In fact, the word we're going to discover is the word criticize. That's a fun word, right? Everyone loves, here's the way that you love it. Pitch it this way. I would just like to provide for you some constructive criticism. So if you put the word constructive in front of criticism, then it's okay, right? Because it's constructive. Ever received constructive criticism? It's still not fun to hear, right? So here's what's happening. Peter is getting word that the people in the circumcision party are criticizing what God has done and what he's been a part of. Social media, political climate, worldwide pandemic. We've never criticized things or people, right? Now, once again, don't hear what I'm not saying. There is a place to ask questions. We're going to discover that in this text also. But there is a place, specifically when it's a move of God, to have what I would call healthy curiosity. To do something like, what if? Does that line up with what I know from Scripture? Is that similar to the attributes of God? Does that highlight the love of God? Does it seem to be the character of God? Peter does a phenomenal job entering into a difficult, sticky, hard conversation and relationship. So ultimately, and I promise we're going to read in a second, what hit me this week is, do relationships with other people matter to me so much that I'm willing to have a hard conversation with another person? And when I say a hard conversation with another person, I'm not saying, so that I can either get them told or they can get me told. The goal for Christians that have strained relationships or difficult things happening or things that aren't understood all the time, the goal is always reconciliation. The goal is, can we talk about these things rather than ignore the giant elephant in the room and trust God in the midst of it to bring about unity and worship of God? That's what happens. Acts 11, beginning with verse 1. Here we go. Now the apostles and the brothers who were throughout Judea heard that the Gentiles also had received the word of God. So when Peter went up to Jerusalem, the circumcision party criticized him, saying, "You went to uncircumcised men and ate with them." But Peter began and explained it to them in order. "I was in the city of Joppa praying, and in a trance I saw a vision, something like a great sheet descending, being let down from heaven by its four corners, and it came down to me. Looking at it closely, I observed animals and beasts of prey and reptiles and birds of the air, and I heard a voice saying to me, 'Rise, Peter, kill and eat.' But I said, 'By no means, Lord, for nothing common or unclean has ever entered my mouth.' But the voice answered a second time from heaven, 'What God has made clean, do not call common.' This happened three times, and all was drawn up again into heaven. And behold, at that very moment, three men arrived at the house in which we were, sent to me from Caesarea. and the Spirit told me to go with them, making no distinction. These six brothers also accompanied me, and we entered the man's house, and he told us how we had seen the angel stand in his house and say, "Send to Joppa and bring Simon, who is called Peter. He will declare to you a message by which you will be saved, you and all your household." As I began to speak, the Holy Spirit fell on them, just as on us at the beginning. And I remembered the word of the Lord, how he said, "John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." If then God gave the same gift to them as he gave to us when we believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I that I could stand in God's way? When they heard these things, they fell silent, and they glorified God, saying, "Then to the Gentiles also God has granted repentance that leads to life." And please pray with me one more time. Father, help us to see what you want us to see in your word today. I pray that you would speak through me. I would be an instrument of your voice. We all need to hear from you. And Lord, I pray that you would increase our faith. Jesus loves me. This I know. Jesus loves people. This I know. For the Bible tells me so. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Word travels fast, even before these things were made. I don't know how it traveled. I don't know how word got back to Jerusalem about this revival. I do know this. When the Holy Spirit fell, and when the Holy Spirit falls in a place, healing, salvation, hope, strength, joy, peace, power, they're all the fruit of the Holy Spirit fallen. And when the Holy Spirit falls in a tangible way, those that are sensitive to what the Holy Spirit is doing don't want to move. They don't want to go anywhere at all. I'll give you a quick example. Jesus, Mount of Transfiguration, remember, there is this Shekinah glory. Moses and Elijah show up. They hear the voice. And what's Peter doing? Peter's like, "Whoa, we do not want to leave this mountain. I got a great idea. I'll make it comfortable for everybody. I'm going to build a tent. But we don't want to go anywhere at all. We want to tarry. We want to stay." Now, that won't be true for every single person. So for some people, in fact, for everybody, it's going to be true a little bit. It's going to be a little uncomfortable. It's going to be a little unusual. It's going to go like, I'm not so sure about this. But you know what? Everything that is really pursuing health isn't comfortable at the beginning. Do you remember when you were learning how to write? Some of you teachers have really gone lax. I got in big trouble because I never held my pen right. I didn't quite understand why it was so important to hold my pen or pencil right. As long as I could make the letters, it was okay. I don't hold my pen or pencil correctly. My kids actually mastered that even more. I don't know how they write at all. But you know what? They do, and it's readable. And so where is he going talking about writing? It wasn't comfortable to learn how to write. It's not easy to learn how to tie your shoes when you're learning. It's not, though it could be fun, and every 15-year-old that just gets their permit thinks they're an excellent driver, right? I know I did. But we learn, and when we're learning something new, we're outside of our comfort zone for a while. That's a normal thing. So leaning into what the Holy Spirit wants to do in our lives is naturally going to be a little bit uncomfortable initially. But as these people who weren't Jews hear the gospel, it's as Peter is speaking, the Holy Spirit falls. And they don't want to leave. Some of you have been in assemblies or worship services where that has been the case. And it can't, unfortunately, be a wave a magic wand or say this certain spell, and then all of a sudden, boom, it happens. I've been guilty of attempting that. Just like C.S. Lewis in the Chronicles of Narnia describes Aslan as not a tame lion. He comes and goes, but he's good, and he's faithful, and he gives us what we need. What's amazing is Peter is not the only Jew witnessing this miracle of the Holy Spirit coming and falling and saving and healing people. Six other brothers that were also Jewish see this too. And sometimes, guys, we just all need to admit the fact we don't know what we don't know. You don't know what you don't know. And it is really easy now, so far removed from Scripture, to look at this circumcision party that are asking questions and being critical and going, oh, well, they're the bad guys. Like, we would never do something like that. They just don't know what they don't know, and they weren't there to experience this move of God. But it does say that they criticized Peter. And I know I mentioned this already, but what's your default when someone criticizes you? I'll give you a few examples or options. Oh, I'm going to criticize them right back. Or, oh, I guess they don't like me very much. I better just keep my distance from them. Or, and this has become a thing and a word, right? Cancel culture. People don't line up with me on every single point, then, well, they're just canceled. The circumcision party could have canceled Peter, and Peter could have canceled the circumcision party. Right? Peter could have said, well, the circumcision party, they can just go and start their own church, and we'll start our church, and it won't take very long before then Cornelius starts his church, and then these six guys that saw something, maybe they all fast it out, and then they all start churches, and boom. Peter goes to the circumcision party and says, hey, let me tell you how I experienced God at work. I think that word God is really important to emphasize here. Because you know, even in the church in Corinth that Paul writes, he says, listen, some of you say, I follow Apollos, and others say, I follow Cephas, and then others say, I follow Paul. And then Paul's trying to say, but aren't we all supposed to be following God? That we will all get in big trouble when we say, I'm going to follow this man or that woman. But if Christians can all say, wait, we all follow God through Jesus, that's the safer way to go. So, Peter goes to these people. What is he being accused of? You went to uncircumcised men and ate with them. Table fellowship under Judaism was a really, really big deal. If you were going to share a meal with that person, then you basically were one heart and one mind and one soul with that person. So going and eating with these people, which by the way, remember, a Jewish man thanked God most every morning that he wasn't three things. One, a woman. Sorry, women. It's history. It's not me. I don't agree with that, but number two, a dog. Dogs in America, at least mine, are treated very, very well. Dogs were scavengers back then, okay? They weren't your pets. And number three, a Samaritan, which actually would be someone who's part Jewish, but not fully Jewish. Okay, so basically, racism was a thing in Bible times. Racism, sadly, is still very much a thing in the here and now, too. And it is from the pit of hell, and God hates racism. And that should be like, yes, of course, no-brainer, but I'll say it because sometimes the waters get muddied. But God hates more than just racism. God hates a selfish, self-righteous pride that any time would put you up here and someone else down here. Some of you will go, well, I don't really think I'm very racist. Well, I hope you're not. I think all of us need to explore the areas where God still is working this out for us. But here's where everyone gets their toes stepped on. There has always been a moment where you put yourself up here and someone else down there. Can I give you an example of driving and road rage? Whenever someone is exercising something called road rage, guess what? You are the excellent driver, and the person who just cut you off or was driving too slow or driving too fast is always beneath you. You are always elevating yourself up high and putting others down low in that situation. That's one example. In the church world, it fleshes itself out sometimes this way. There are people who, when they worship, they raise their hands, and they think everyone else should raise their hands. And then there are people who, when they worship, are more quiet and don't raise their hands, and they think everyone should worship just like them. Guess what's happening? You're putting yourself and your preferences way up here and everyone else down below. And the reason why I'm bringing this up, number one, is because if you really ask God, God, show me the times in my life when I put myself up here and everyone else down low, like, you'll be wanting to sin before the throne of God over and over and over again, because God is going to show you all the ways that you do this in any given day. And you go, wow, God, thank you that there is one who doesn't bid me thence depart. There is one who is my advocate before the Father. There is one who pleads my case before the Father. Because when I'm realizing the sin of self-righteousness, I am looking at myself and going, whoa, I don't have a leg to stand on. And then there will be a temptation, even in the here and now, right now, this moment, to go, oh, but I'm really not that bad. I'm not like my neighbor or coworker or whatever, and go, well, you just gave yourself away. The evidence that the self-righteousness runs deep in you. So there is the circumcision party. And oftentimes, self-righteousness can run after a noble thing. The circumcision party may have been thinking they were very, very noble. So we're pleading our case. We're zealous for truth. We're making sure we keep things pure. But here's the beautiful thing. They are willing to listen to Peter. It's been said often, and in fact, in our last elder meeting, it came up again. It was close to Father's Day, and we talked about things we want to instill upon our children, and one of our elders said that they remind their kids that God has given us two ears and one mouth for a reason. That perhaps we're supposed to listen twice as much as we speak. So this circumcision party says, Peter, we want to talk with you about these things. And Peter begins and explains in verse 4, and he retells the whole story. And because we did that last week, I'm not going to retell this story again, other than to say this. Because it is true that I could have said, in one sermon. We're going to do Acts 10 all the way through 11, chapter 11, verse 18, because it's basically the same story. I'm going to say it's not exactly because of the way that the circumcision party and Peter interact, number one, and number two, themes that are repeated specifically in Scripture are probably super important. So the fact that this is repeated again highlights that for the early church, them being brought along and them journeying to, whoa, wait, Jesus died for the world, including Gentiles, including those that I would think maybe he didn't die for. We really need to get this. And it's repeated again. The other thing is, when you have an experience with God, a life-changing experience, you're going to talk about that more than once. It's not going to be hard for you to repeat those experiences. So, what's amazing about this is, Peter says, guess what? I didn't think it was a good idea either. These were unclean things. I wasn't sure. I was pushing back as well. He remembers he had to be brought along too, which maybe says something even just about Christian friendship and Christian discipleship. If you do think that you are, quote unquote, more mature than another Christian believer, number one, be careful. But number two, remember this. Go slow. See where somebody is rather than where they're not. Okay, be an example of my brother-in-law that is a marathon runner who qualified for and ran the Boston Marathon in 2018. And me saying, hey, I would really like to run with you. And he says, okay, tomorrow I'm running 20 miles. Let's go. I've lost before I've started, right? There's no way I can do 20 miles. And because my brother-in-law loves me and is smart and is a coach, in addition to a number of other things he is, he's going to tell me, all right, let's start with 3. Or maybe right now, let's start with 1. And he's going to help take me step by step by step through this process. So Peter demonstrates a great deal of love and a great deal of patience with the circumcision party. And the beautiful thing is, at the end of it, after these 6 witnesses are there as well, in verse 17, says, if then God gave them the same gift to them as he gave to us when we believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I that I could stand in God's way? It's not a bad question to ask, guys. You don't know what God is doing in the heart of another person. And as long as it doesn't contradict God's word or go against God's word, you can look at this and say, who am I to stand in the way of what God is doing in this moment? And then when they heard these things, they fell silent. Now, here's what I think. The Holy Spirit is preparing this meeting. The Holy Spirit is giving ears to hear. The Holy Spirit is giving teachable hearts. But silent, they fell silent. They stopped protesting. They stopped saying, I know all the answers. And they entered into this much healthier place to be as, wow, God, you are always amazing me with doing new things that I wouldn't understand or always predict would happen. When they heard these things, they fell silent. And this is interesting. They fell silent and they glorified God. How do you fall silent and glorify God at the same time? Doesn't glorify God mean praise the Lord? Well, it could. But there is also a stand in awe of God, holiness, of being wowed by Him, where your heart is glorifying Him. Then to the Gentiles also, God has granted repentance that leads to life. Jesus loves me. This I know, for the Bible tells me so. God grants repentance to another human being. And the welcoming team owns this and believes this, but I often say if someone walks through the front door of this building when we have worship services, then God is already at work in that person's life. And some of you go, I only walk through the front doors because mom or dad told me to, or my spouse wouldn't quit bugging me, or I'm in from out of town and just want to see somebody I know, or fill in the blank. Well, yeah, that may be your perspective. That may be your thought process. But God has invited you to this place, to meet with Him, to know Him better. And He invites you and wants you to be open, to have a healthy curiosity of, what if, God? And you know what happens when we have that healthy curiosity? We begin to hear. God will give you an ear to hear something you didn't before hear. I had one more thing that I was going to share. But I'm not sure I'm going to. You guys would be really upset if church ended a little bit earlier today, right? Here's the other thing that I want to say. I'm not sure it's supposed to end earlier. I'm going to ask Joe and Becky to kind of come up. And I want us to spend a little bit of time reflecting on how open are you to God doing something that maybe He hasn't done in the past for you. And first of all, it just starts with that question. How open are you to that? And guys, I'm going to be honest. For some of you, you're just going to say, like, and be honest with your heart. I'm not open to that. I just want to continue to kind of go through the motions of what this is. And it's a good thing. And I try to be a good person. And I want to raise my family right. And for me, that's enough. Like, that's enough for me. That's enough for you. Okay, that's where you are right now. But for others of you, there's a stirring. There's a hunger. There's a hunger because there's an emptiness that needs to be filled. And you don't even know what that is or what that might look like. Cornelius feared God, it says in Acts 10. He gave to people generously. He was a good person, but he wanted more. And God gave him a vision, and then God gave Peter a vision to come and send him a message. And then this circumcision party, initially they criticized, but then Peter came to them, and as Peter came to them, they fell silent, and they glorified God. And they experienced God in a new way and doing a new thing. And some of you, God has given you a sensitivity and a hunger and a desire. And this is an invitation to say, don't squelch that. Don't tell that desire to shut up. And don't believe, oh, well, that'll probably never really happen for me. Jesus loves you. And if there's an emptiness in your heart that only he can fill, and he loves you, he intends to fill that for you. So here's what I'm wondering. Can this text be more than black ink on white paper? Can this word of God from the God who became flesh and dwelt among us do a miracle in our hearts and in this place and in this church family where we also will fall silent and glorify God? I long for that. I desire that. And I don't believe I'm alone. So Joe, Becky, I'm not sure what we're supposed to play, what we're supposed to sing. But I know this. I know I want to provide some space this morning where we can say, Jesus, would you perform a miracle in me so I may fall silent and glorify you in a way I haven't previously? And guys, whether you want to raise your hands or sit quietly, there's freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Whether you want to sit in your pew or you want to come forward or you want to grab someone and say, hey, would you pray with me for this? Whatever it is, I invite you to listen to the Lord. Father, thank you that you intend to perform miracles continually in our hearts. And just like you gave the circumcision party an ear to hear, just like you worked in Peter to show him how he does something new, I pray that you would do that in us this morning as a people. And that we would have courage, God, to be led by you today. Not thinking we know it all, but putting our hand in the one who does know it all. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Just going to provide space for prayer for you all.
Tells me of the guilt within.
Sing this song together.
What love could remember, no wrongs we have done, omniscient, all knowing, he counts not their sum, thrown into a sea without bottom or shore. Our sins, they are. Would wait as we constantly roam. What Father so tender is calling us home. He welcomes the weakest, the vilest, the poor. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Praise the of kindness he lavished on us. His blood was the payment, his life was the cost. We stood neath the debt we could never afford. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the
Our sins, they are many, but His mercy is more. And that truth, married to Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so, brings life. It brings adoption into the family of God. And when you are able to confess with your heart, confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, the Bible tells you, you will be saved, rescued. And the penalty for your sin and the punishment will be passed over. So you can say with good hope and assurance, My sins there are many, but his mercy is more. I'm going to invite you guys. I want Joe to just continue playing a little bit longer. I'm going to invite you guys to sit. I've got one more thing, and then we've got two other things. That equals three things, right? Maybe we're not going to get out of here early. Anyway, this came to me on my drive to church today. Cornelius and his crew, Peter and his six witnesses, and the circumcision party. I saw them in the parable of the prodigal son. And then you have the father. And I saw Cornelius and his crew wanting to be in that home of the father. And then I saw Peter reluctantly going home, wanting to be that dutiful older son to try to do what his father thinks would be right. And then his father saying, no, no, they're included. The house is big enough. The family is big enough. And then the circumcision party coming home. And that as the father kills the fattened calf, all of them are falling silent and glorifying God and rejoicing together. And then I began to think, that's going to happen one fine day. One day with a capital D, Jesus is going to come back for his people. And whatever little things we felt like divided us are going to be united under him and under Jesus. And now one thing about the 4th of July, I love this holiday. I love to blow stuff up. I'm proud to be an American. But, Christian, if you think that you celebrate an Independence Day, you are wrong. The Christian celebrates a Dependence Day. But it is depending on God, who through Jesus paid the price for your sins and teaches you day by day to depend on him and his love and his truth and his faithfulness. So, for America, yes, happy Independence Day. But for the family of God and people of God, not just the 4th of July, every day becomes a Dependence Day. So, we're going to switch gears. I've got two announcements. Well, one announcement and one commissioning opportunity. We already heard we're doing an alpha course. We're going to queue up a short video that talks a little bit about this course that we're doing this fall. And this course is something that is awesome because it's worldwide and anyone and everyone can be a part of this. We have a leadership team. If you're wondering how you can serve, come talk to me. But this gives a little bit more info about what is going to be coming up in the fall. So we'll push play on that. And Joe and Becky, I was unscripted, so were you guys. Thank you for being led by the Spirit in that. Amen.
Having conversations about life, faith, and Jesus is hard. And this is interesting because at some point, everyone wrestles with life's big questions. Questions about hope, purpose, meaning, and love. Imagine creating a space where people in our community, our friends, neighbors, and coworkers, can come and have conversations in a way that is authentic and unforced. Where leaders don't need to have all the answers, and anyone can ask tough questions and share honestly about what they believe. That's what Alpha is all about. Alpha started in a church in London years ago with a simple idea to engage friends who might not typically go to church. Lives were transformed, and it began to grow all over the world. Today, you can find Alpha in schools, coffee shops, church buildings, prisons, and homes. And so far, millions of people have experienced Alpha. So what is Alpha? Alpha is a series of interactive sessions exploring the basics of the Christian faith. In each session, you eat food, listen to a talk, and have discussions in small groups. Eating food together creates space for people to connect, relax, and build friendships. The talks tackle core questions about life and faith from a Christian perspective. And the discussion allows people to unpack these ideas without fear of being corrected or judged. All of this is done in a fun environment where anyone is welcome. There are three main sets of talks you could use: the Alpha Film Series, Alpha with Nikki Gumbel, and the Alpha Youth Series. Each is designed with a different audience in mind and is typically run over 8 to 12 weeks, with a weekend away where there are opportunities to experience worship through music and moments for prayer. Alpha also comes with everything you need to empower others to be involved, like discussion guides and training videos for you and your team. And all the talks and tools are available online and can be downloaded for free. By running Alpha, you're creating a space where people can connect with each other and connect with God. Sign up, get started, run Alpha today.
So I think next week there'll be an opportunity with some invitation cards, but here's what I want you to begin doing now. One, ask God, hey, am I supposed to be a part of, like, should I sign up for this course? Number one. Number two, who do I know that may be open to having that healthy curiosity about God and the things of God that I could extend an invitation to invite? And it'll be every Wednesday from 6 to, I think, 8:15 is the time frame for Alpha. And it is an 11-week commitment. I know that's huge, especially in this culture. But if you think about it like a course that's fun because it's food and great people, okay? And I had some college courses that were fun, but I never had a college course that included food. We're going to serve you dinner and dessert, and it's going to be quality. So, anyway, that's it for Alpha. And then Mountaintop Mission Trip people, if you guys want to come forward. One thing that we were supposed to do in 2020, and for some reason it didn't work out in 2020, is Mike and Gwen Solomon have a relationship with a mission organization called Mountaintop in Tennessee, and they are taking off on Saturday morning around 9. And a lot of you guys, I got both pages here. It's a front and back. You guys may have gotten one of these on your way in. What's cool about this is whenever people from the bridge go on mission, it's sort of like our entire church getting invited on mission. These guys are going to actually go to Tennessee. But we can be praying for, encouraging, lifting them up, even mailing them things, but you need to send it early because our post office system isn't really the most punctual nowadays. And so send it early if you're going to send any mail. But they are excited to go, and they know, like, they're going to do what they can do, but God is going to intervene and show up and do abundantly more. We're going to have an opportunity to pray, commissioning prayer for them. And just in the way of solidarity, if you feel led, if you want to extend an arm out toward this group as we pray, feel free to do that. And let's pray for them. Father, thank you so much for the gift of these people who are part of our church family and loved deeply by us. I pray, Lord, for Mike and Gwen and Nikki as they lead as adults, and for each one of these kids, Lord, that they would experience profound, transforming encounters with your Son, our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, I pray that you would go before them and behind them and on each side of them, providing them with protection and power and unity and safety, Lord, and also courage to go where you tell them, to say what you tell them, to do what you tell them. Lord, may they have a posture even now to fall silent and glorify you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Also, Mike just told me we had two people that had to cancel last minute. It is in the home stretch. But some of you out there today may be going, what, two open spots? Maybe I should ask God, God, do you want me to join this great group up here and go to Mountaintop with them? Two spots. There's still time. If you're interested, talk to Mike, Gwen, Nikki. We'll get you on the list. And yeah, sorry about the whole promise. You'll get out early. But let's do a benediction. All right, let's receive this. Father, thank you so much for how you've moved in our midst today. Thank you that your mercy is greater than all our sins. Lord, as we leave this place, may our posture be to fall silent and glorify you together as your people. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Happy 4th of July. God bless you all.